gentlemen, we are here at Dr. Hearing on Bonk in case of Tibble versus Edison. As you can see, Judge Silverman is appearing by video from Phoenix. Can you hear us, Judge Silverman?
Yes, thank you, Chief.
Okay. You may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor, and may it please the Court. I am Michael Wolf, attorney for the plaintiff's appellants. The Court should remand this case for trial on plaintiff's claims of fiduciary breach regarding the use of retail class mutual funds in their retirement plan because the United States Supreme Court vacated the basis on which the District Court granted summary judgment against those claims. The District Court believed, following the logic of Phillips versus Alaska, restaurant and hotel employees pension fund, that where there are a series of breaches of the same character, and some of those breaches occurred outside of the six-year limitations period, the breaches that occurred within the limitations period are no longer actionable because they're barred. The Supreme Court held that that was incorrect. In essence, the District Court held that only the selection decision to include retail mutual funds in the plan is the actionable breach, and that the decision to retain those funds in the plan is not an actionable breach. The Supreme Court said exactly the opposite. The Supreme Court said, in essence, in its decision, a fiduciary's allegedly imprudent retention of an investment is an action or omission that triggers the running of the six-year limitations period.
Can I ask you, what do we as the en banc court need to decide?
The court needs to decide whether this case should be remanded or not.
No, isn't it? I thought when the Supreme Court sent it back to our court, one of the issues that was raised at the end of the opinion was whether or not duty to monitor the claim had been waived, whether you'd failed to preserve it. Is that right?
The court...
That's what the three-judge panel went off on, correct?
Yes, the three-judge panel decided the case on remand on the basis of this forfeiture issue. And so this court can decide that forfeiture issue, and the case can decide that forfeiture issue fairly easily because the appellees, the defendants in this case, never asserted that plaintiffs could have tried these claims at trial.
So if I don't know yet, this is a complicated long record, but if we were to agree with you that the claim is not forfeited, what do we do?
We remand.
Do we just send it back to the district court and say, proceed on in light of what the Supreme Court said?
Yes, Your Honor, because the decision in the district court was a summary judgment against the plaintiffs on those claims. On the basis that, because of the series of breaches starting outside of the limitations period, all of the breaches are barred under the limitations statute, which is no longer valid. So,
do we have to tell the district court to vacate its judgment? Summary judgment in favor of the defendants?
Yes, as to the retail mutual fund claims. Correct. And allow plaintiffs to proceed to trial on the full extent of the mutual funds that are at issue.
How many funds are there, in your view, that are still at issue?
There was evidence of 14 total mutual funds that had cheaper share classes. Six of those were tried. Three because they were selected within the limitations period. Three plaintiffs attempted to argue that there was a significant change in circumstances.
Three left.
No, Your Honor, there are eight left. So
the Supreme Court didn't seem to think there were eight left, so I'm a little confused about the number and what was argued at the Supreme Court and why the number might be different now.
Right. Well, so because there was a trial in this case and a record developed as to that trial, and the case basically got distilled down to those funds, that was the main focus in the Supreme Court argument. The question of how many actual funds there are or not really isn't an issue, and that's something for the district court to resolve.
Counsel, help me with this. Putting aside arguendo for a moment, the waiver issue. The Supreme Court said that the Ninth Circuit didn't properly consider trust law, and that ERISA is a trust law situation. All of the
certain extent because the trial court actually found that the failure to use the cheaper version of the same mutual fund is a breach. That's very clear cut. The issue that happened at summary judgment was that the court said, well, if that's been going on for more than 6 years, it's no longer actionable, so I don't need to address.
But doesn't that deal with the question of whether this is a continuing duty as opposed to a one-time duty? When you make the selection of the fund, the decision is made unless the yield is different as far as the outside investments. But so far as the fees are concerned, perhaps I misunderstood, but I thought there was a limitation because the court thought, okay, they bought these funds, here's the date, 6 years later, you're out of luck. But if the law is that on an ongoing basis, the ERISA trustee, in this case Edison, has an obligation to continually determine that the administrative fees charged to the beneficiaries are the lowest fees available in the class, in this case retail versus institutional, and that's an ongoing breach, and the six-year statute of limitations would be running. Is that correct? Have I misunderstood something?
In a sense, Your Honor, sometimes we get hung up over, is it an ongoing breach or is it a repeated breach every time they review the funds and decide to keep the same menu of funds in there, or decide, well, we don't have to look at whether a cheaper share class is better for this plan or not. Every time they make that decision to not look at that factor, that's an independent breach. Another way of looking at it is these mutual funds charge these fees every year, so every year that the excessive fees are being charged, there's a new breach.
And if that happens, then the statute of limitations would start at that point, right?
Correct, Your Honor. So that even if the breach is similar over a 10-year period of time, the participants only allowed to sue for the breaches that occurred within the past.
So in that circumstance, let's assume that there's Fund A, whatever it is. It's bought in year one, and every year there's a retail fee charge at the same time that Edison was able to get the same fund at an institutional fee. Every year, is there not, under the scenario we discussed, a new breach from which a statute of limitations would run?
Yes, Your Honor, and that's what the Supreme Court held also.
Right, so that gets me back then to my original question. The district court decided a number of things about a number of these funds, but did not apply, if I understood it correctly, that particular principle. Did it apply that principle, or did it not apply that principle?
It applied the principle that you have to either use the cheaper share class or have a good reason for not doing so, but only as to the funds that were selected within the 6-year period. It did not apply that principle to the funds that had been selected outside that period, and wasn't presented evidence.
If those funds that were chosen and the district courts that were going to look at this, if there's an annual breach under the scenario that we discussed, then each one is a new breach. The statute of limitations would continue, and there would be a new cause of action potentially, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And I'd just like to emphasize the plaintiff's position is not that you have to use the cheaper share class per se, because there may be a reason for having the more expensive share class, although I probably wouldn't be able to articulate it for you. The fiduciaries have to at least have a reasoned decision for why they're choosing what appears to be an imprudent course of action. And if they show a prudent process, then ERISA generously gives them the benefit of the doubt on that, frankly.
The controlling authority was Phillips, in large part, before this decision. Do we need to overrule Phillips in light of the Supreme Court opinion?
You do not, Your Honor, because Phillips only concerned the 3-year limitations period under ERISA, which is an actual knowledge limitation, so that once you have actual knowledge of a breach, you have 3 years in which to bring suit. And Phillips, I believe, correctly decided that you can't equitably toll that for whatever reason.
So to the extent that it involved a continuing duty or said anything about that, then Phillips would be inconsistent.
To a certain extent, as applied to a 6-year period. So keep in mind here, the participants didn't have actual knowledge of the breach because they weren't privy to taking jurisprudence as to an actual knowledge three-year limitation and applying it to no actual knowledge six-year limitation. So that where there's a series of breaches of the same character and you have actual knowledge of those breaches, then you have 3 years in which to bring suit, arguably.
Well, here's what the district court said, and I'm quoting, there is no continuing violation theory to claim subject to ERISA statute of limitations, citing Phillips.
Yes. And as to the three-year actual knowledge limitation, that's true.
Okay.
And I
take your point.
And the factual circumstances in that case are somewhat unique, too. So there, you've got the pension fund that's in surplus, and the question is, do we enhance the benefits for the currently vested participants, or do we ease the vesting requirements for those participants who are contributing, like the plaintiff in that case, and the fiduciaries there had made a decision to enhance the benefits of the participants under the current vesting schedule and not give plaintiff any of its benefits, and then he started receiving his benefits after that point, and he attempted to argue, well, each time I got a check that was less than I could have, had you enhanced my benefits, that was a similar breach. And that's questionable, I think, as to whether that's actually a breach or not. That's just the ongoing effects of the decision not to change the vesting schedule early on. And the plaintiff knew about the fact that the fiduciary society were not going to change the vesting schedule and didn't bring suit within 3 years from that point. Here it's different. So there, the fiduciaries don't have an ongoing duty to reconsider the vesting schedule for a defined benefit pension plan. Here, the fiduciaries clearly do. The fiduciaries have a clearly recognized duty to remove imprudent funds from a retirement plan. And that duty applies regardless of how long those imprudent funds have been in the plan. And what the Supreme Court says was, just because those imprudent funds have been in there for more than 6 years doesn't mean that the fiduciaries are off the hook. The whole point of the common law duty to monitor and remove imprudent funds means that you've got to get rid of an imprudent fund, regardless of how long it's been there.
Counsel, I was interested in the court's treatment of the, what I call the revenue sharing. If having the beneficiaries pay retail fees cost them money out of pocket, and the trustee shares in those fees, normally that would be a fiduciary breach. Why isn't that so in this case?
Your Honor, I think that's a good question, and we contend that it is a fiduciary breach, but the panel on the first appeal
that's not good anymore.
Rejected our arguments on that. And I believe the district court said, well, the plan allowed for that to happen. There wasn't a claim that the total compensation was excessive.
What was there a disclosure to the beneficiaries of the revenue sharing? Did the plan itself say that that was okay?
No.
Okay, so in what way was it disclosed or approved?
Well, the plan provided that the employer, Edison, shall pay the cost of administering the plan.
Right.
And the district and the fiduciary said, well, that's, we'll pay the cost of administering the plan net of any offsets. And they said, well, by investing in these retail mutual funds, we're getting an offset for the amount of that revenue sharing that's going on, and we're paying the net, so we're in compliance with the terms of the
plan. But the beneficiaries didn't approve it, right?
Correct.
And the plan itself did not disclose, at least that I could find, anything it says that we, Edison, have the right to take a piece of the fees that you're being charged to pay our bookkeeping costs.
Correct.
Is that right?
Correct, Your Honor. And it's our position that that's a clear-cut breach and a conflict of interest for all of the reasons we argued in the first appeal. But
well, can I direct your attention to the issue which appears in Tibble 2, which is whether your claim of breach of the duty to monitor was forfeited or not. Now, what's your position as to whether you made a claim for duty to monitor as to the mutual funds, not as to the money market fund, but as to mutual funds at trial? Do you claim that you made that claim?
Well, Your Honor, not at trial, because that claim was precluded by the summary judgment order.
How was it precluded by
is the summary judgment order said that when you have breaches of a similar character and breaches that occur outside of the limitations period, you can't pursue a claim as to the breaches that occur within the limitations period. And only as to those funds that have been in for more than 6 years, you have to show significantly changed circumstances to merit a full due diligence review, tantamount to deciding to put the funds in the first place.
Well, what you're saying is the trial judge rejected your claim regarding duty to monitor.
The judge didn't consider it because the judge said it was barred by the limitation statute. Because as to those funds that were...
Your position is that you raise that claim in trial.
No, Your Honor, we're saying that we were barred from raising
it. Right,
no,
you raised the claim. Did you raise it
in the district court?
Did you raise it before trial? Was it a claim, part of your claim?
Yes.
Was it a complaint, correct?
Yes. Yes, I know.
It was in the contentions of fact and law.
Well, the contentions of fact...
Prior to trial.
Retrial.
Order.
Retrial.
That, as to the funds that were outside the limitations period, since the summary judgment order barred it, that was not in the proposed findings and conclusions for the issue.
I'm not talking about proposed findings. But pretrial, they allow you to file what's called contentions of fact and law. What the dispute is going to be at trial.
Right.
Yes. And if I remember correctly, there was a brief discussion about the statute of limitations and how it had been how the statute had precluded certain claims.
Yes. Yes, correct. And there was discussion of the fact that we are including some of the pre-limitations mutual funds under the court's summary judgment order to allow us to argue significant change in circumstances. And here's what we think are the changed circumstances.
Didn't you emphasize the changed circumstances argument and not raise the duty, the breaches of duty into monitor argument on the motion of summary judgment?
No, Your Honor. The statute of limitations got very little treatment in the summary judgment briefing. It was basically a few lines, and the court just misapplied Phillips to the 6-year limitations to say that for mutual funds that have been in there for more than 6 years, you've got to come up with something new that happened within the limitations period, not prior. In fact, what the court said that, the court said on ER 79, there's an independent breach each time a fiduciary chose a mutual fund for inclusion in the plan in order to maximize revenue sharing to the detriment of the plan participants. So we were looking at trial of, well, okay, we've got three that were actually chosen, but we have these other three that has significant enough change that the decision to keep them in the plan was as if they were new. So it did sort of spark that full due diligence review that defendants and the court said was the only thing you can assert as to pre-limitations selected funds. The court again said on ER 93, it is undisputed that the initial decision to add retail mutual funds, including the sector funds, as an option in the plan was made in 1999 and 2000. The prudence claims arising out of these decisions are barred by the statute of limitations. And that all sprang from the court's application of Phillips to the 6-year period based on, again, string of breaches of the similar character. If any of them is outside the limitations period, throw them apart.
Are any of your arguments at the motion of summary judgment stage, you mentioned the duty to monitor?
We didn't use that exact phrase, Your Honor. What we said, right, but Your Honor, what we said repeatedly, both, especially on the first time in this appeal, and that's where this whole forfeiture issue comes up, we repeatedly stated that a fiduciary has a continuing duty, we use that phrase all the time, to remove imprudent investment options.
You didn't use the term of duty to monitor.
Correct, Your Honor, and that's because there wasn't any question about the duty.
Well, what's the difference between a continuing obligation and a duty to monitor? Is there any difference?
Frankly, Your Honor, I don't see that there is much of a difference. You have a duty to remove imprudent investment options. Arguably, if they were imprudent for more than 6 years, the statute of limitations may bar any claim for breach of that duty. But since that's a continuing duty, breaches of the duty to remove imprudent investment options are actionable that occur within 6 years. The duty to monitor in this case wasn't really an issue because everybody agreed that Edison was regularly monitoring the mutual funds that were in this plan. It just chose not to look at the reasons why and whether to go outside of the limitations mutual funds because of the thought that, well, I mean, our decision was we're in the clear.
The decision says that you not only forfeited the duty to monitor a claim in the trial court, but doubly forfeited by not raising it in an opening brief. How do you respond to that?
I think the appellate court, the panel, has an impossible interpretation of an appellate brief in coming to that conclusion. I would direct this court to pages 18 through 21 of our brief, where we go over and over with citation to cases that repeatedly refer to the fact that a fiduciary has an ongoing duty to remove and prudent investment options. We state, ERISA imposes a continuing duty upon plan fiduciaries to discharge their duties to the plan loyally and prudently. We cite Martin versus Consultant and Administrators, Inc. for the point that ERISA's fiduciary duties regarding plan investments is of a continuing nature to review plan investments and eliminate imprudent ones.
You also cited Brockfield versus Cohen.
Yes. But again, we state expressly, citing a Seventh Circuit decision that says this, a continuing duty to review plan investments and eliminate imprudent ones.
Is it your position, counsel, that but for the summary judgment order, you would have been ready at trial to present evidence of a failure in the or breach of the duty to monitor, such that if we were to send it back, you'd be ready to try that claim or ask to those funds without additional discovery?
Yes, that's correct, Your Honor, with the possible exception of being presenting the damages calculations as to the other eight mutual funds, which is frankly just a mathematical calculation, taking the fee differential and the asset levels and then bringing it forward to the present day. But as to the actual fiduciary action, the liability aspect of it, Your Honor is correct, because the court did look at what Edison did, and the court did already find Edison just didn't consider the cheaper share classes and came up with no reason why. They went with the more expensive share class. So the court's reexamination of that same evidence is going to come up with the same result as to the other eight mutual funds.
Do you have expert opinions already on the issue of duty to monitor then? Is that how I understand the answer you just gave?
Yes, we presented an expert who stated that the mutual funds are exactly the same. There's no reason not to be in the cheaper share class, even for those mutual funds that state in their SEC filings that they have certain minimums. They would waive that minimum for a plan of this size. And the district court found the expert's testimony on that to be reliable and believable, and relied on that in granting us judgment on the three mutual funds that were selected within the limitations period. And he did identify the fact that there are these other mutual funds that are out there that aren't being addressed because of the summary judgment order.
But the discovery would have happened before the summary judgment order, right? So that's why, on the eight more funds, is there no discussion by the expert of those funds? And why would that have been? That can't be blamed on the summary judgment order that happened later.
Right, no, he did point out that there were a total of 14 funds that had cheaper share classes, and then discusses generally the fact that the mutual funds are the same, and for all mutual funds, the practice is that they will go, they will allow investment below the stated minimums when a plan is of the size this one is. So that testimony would apply to all of the mutual funds. It wasn't unique to the particular mutual funds that were addressed at trial.
Yeah, we've got 5 minutes left. Do you want to reserve it for rebuttal?
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. My name is John Hacker, counsel for the Edison parties. As the argument we've heard thus far makes clear, the threshold issue here is whether the plaintiffs were barred by the summary judgment order, pretrial summary judgment order, from asserting an argument at trial that Edison, during its regular monitoring process, should have recognized that the three funds they challenged at trial were, the fees in those funds were too high, and should have switched those funds into the institutional share classes.
And the issue is whether they forfeited their claim.
Right. And their position today, as it was has always been is what Supreme Court is. They didn't forfeit it because the summary judgment order told them not to argue.
First, you have to find out whether they forfeited the claim and not an argument. As you know, a theory or an argument is not the same as a claim. They made a claim that you failed to fulfill your duty of prudence in examining these on a continual basis. They made an argument that, following what the district court said, they made an argument that there should be based on particular circumstances. They may have, as I understand your theory, they forfeited that argument where that argument was wrong. But I don't understand where you say they forfeited the claim of failure to exercise prudence in re-examining these investments on a continuing basis.
Because, first of all, they didn't even argue, it's not an allegation in the complaint, to clarify a question earlier, that there was a breach of the duty to monitor post-selection the retail mutual funds. They never even asserted that. They didn't argue before summary judgment. If you look at the summary judgment briefs, Your Honors, you will not find an argument asserted by plaintiffs.
Which complaint? You started with a complaint. You say they never made an argument that there was a duty to monitor on a continuing basis.
The retail mutual funds that were included in 1999. There was an argument about sector funds, a claim about sector funds, I believe. But as the case developed, for sure, at the summary judgment argument, in their brief, they chose to make whatever arguments they had available in urging us, defending against summary judgment. They did not argue before summary judgment that there was a breach of the duty to monitor retail mutual funds with respect to the share class issue. That issue was introduced into this case, Your Honors, for the first time about a week before trial by the plaintiffs themselves. That's the first time anybody mentioned the share class issue. It wasn't in play at summary judgment. At summary judgment, the plaintiffs made one argument about the limitations period. One argument. And that argument was that the limitations period didn't apply at all because there was fraud and concealment. And the district court addressed that argument and rejected it. And I think it's so important to understand what happened here to look at what the summary judgment argument that I think both sides are in order. I think both sides agree is dispositive here. If the order barred them from making the argument.
I think they do agree that because they are saying they argued this continuing duty on appeal. And on appeal, then you never said, well, wait a second, they didn't argue this in summary judgment. And I looked at your appellate brief, I didn't see this. So how do you respond to that part?
Let me answer that, but I do want to go back to the summary judgment order itself because I think the appeal is a secondary issue and whether or not it's doubly forfeited.
Well, they don't think so. They think it's the primary issue.
Well, I mean, they argue that we forfeited the argument of forfeiture. I think that's not accurate because we argued on appeal. We understood their argument on appeal to have been a continuing violations argument that they didn't have to talk about the monitoring duty. The breach and what it was that breached the monitoring duty. Yes, in their brief they mentioned the duty to monitor, but if you look at the exact pages Mr. Wolf cited, duty to monitor comes up as a reason that it's a continuing violation. The first argument.
Why is that wrong? I mean, why doesn't that mean you need to respond and say, wait a second, this is new?
Because it wasn't new. The continuing violation argument was based on their understanding of what the judge had said at the beginning of his order about the judge explicitly said there's no continuing violation argument. And they said, yes, there is. That's why we were entitled to challenge these funds, even though we were added before 1999, because we're attacking the initial decision and the failure to rectify that original decision. That was the argument they were making on appeal, and we understood that to be a continuing violation argument, an incorrect argument, because the duty to monitor is a different duty. It requires you to show different things, both legally and factually, and they never tried to do that trial.
What? Sorry, different. What duty to monitor is different than what?
Than the duty that you have as a fiduciary at the initial selection stage. Those are two different. It's all one duty of prudence, but at the selection stage, all the treatises, and I think the Supreme Court recognized that at the selection stage, a fiduciary normally has a duty to do a very extensive market-wide review in determining whether or not to add Fund A versus Fund B versus Fund C, and it's a much more extensive review.
No, okay, so it's different. So on appeal, when they start saying there was a duty to monitor, why didn't you say something about it having been waived below?
because they didn't waive their continuing violation argument. They're only mentioning the duty to monitor to prove that there is a continuing violation theory, and we argued that
there's not. So if that's true, then it wasn't waived below, because it's the same. I don't understand. It's either waived below or it's not, and then it's either waived on appeal or it's not. And you can't. How can you interpret it differently at the two levels?
Because it's the nature of the two arguments and the nature of what it was they were complaining about. And this is why I want to go back to the summary judgment order if I can. Look at page ER18.
Counsel, can I just ask you this? I just have candidly, I don't buy the waiver argument at all. To me, it's you both had your issues. It's a definitional issue. You waived in certain places and they did the other. And we can waive your waiver. So I want to get to the fiduciary issue. Do you agree that for the purposes of a beneficiary, that when Edison charges or permits a charge of a retail fee as opposed to an institutional fee, that the beneficiary earns less money?
Well, the beneficiary in that investment will be paid. I mean, it's not clear. It depends on what the other available options are.
I've had to be real.
If the fee is lower or higher, that will affect their profit from that investment. Yes.
Right, and particularly over a period of time, if you have an interest-bearing investment, that if the amount of money that's available to be compounded is reduced by a higher fee, then the beneficiary is hurt, right?
Well, I wouldn't concede that they're hurt.
I'm assuming if you earn less money, you're hurt.
In that respect, you yes.
Okay. So under those circumstances, when you look at the restatement of trust third, particularly section 90, it talks about an obligation on the part of the trustee to continually monitor costs.
Sure.
Do you agree that in this particular case, while Edison clearly monitored the results of the investment, that it did not continually monitor costs?
It absolutely monitored costs. It always, what it monitored for performance was performance net of fees. So it's always looking at that net of fees.
Okay, but more work with me here. I think that, as we just discussed, the fees affect the performance. I don't think I can monitor net of fees. The fees affect the results. So. And that's why I'm troubled about why Edison didn't say, well, we've got these institutional fees, they're half or a third of what the retail fees are. Our beneficiaries would do so much better if we put them in the institutional funds. And what I want to know is, under trust law, why that didn't happen.
So first of all, I want to disagree with you that waiver is not an issue.
I get your point. I'm just telling you candidly. It's sophistry. I mean, you're all back and forth, but it's all definitional. But the bottom line is, if we want to as a court, we can waive the whole waiver issue. We can get to the merits. So let's assume, just to argue, whether that we're going to do that. So what I want to do is work with the trust law here. Tell me why.
The most important answer to your question is, under those circumstances, if the majority of the rest of the panel agrees with you that they actually had an opportunity to make this argument at trial, then you would need to remand and have a trial judge investigate and have evidence and competing experts introduce evidence as to the answer to your question. There's just not a record here that can establish. But the differences are, the reason you don't just have a duty to go get the cheapest fund, no court has ever said that. The Seventh Circuit and Hecker explicitly said to the contrary, that you don't have a duty to scour the market and look for the cheapest fund, because there are so many other issues that matter to participants, including transparency, performance history, whether there's a Morningstar rating, and those are all relevant to the difference between institutional share classes and retail share classes.
Absolutely. You want to listen to me, okay? I hear what you're saying. I get the fact that it would have to go back to the trial court. A lot would have to be considered. There may be extenuating circumstances. I'm just trying to get to the basics. I think we've thus far concluded that retail funds are more expensive than institutional managed funds. It affects the investment of the beneficiaries over a long term. Over 30, 40 years, it can reduce results by half. That's pretty clear. So I guess what I understand you to be saying is, if we were to certain that these fees are among the things that are continually monitored, then you have to go back to the district court, determine whether Edison has another reason commensurate with ERISA why it didn't do that. Is that a correct statement?
I'd be loath to endorse every word of it because I'm not sure all it takes, but I think that is the issue on appeal. That would be the issue on trial, and it was the issue they had every opportunity to argue at trial, and it's the issue they did argue, Your Honors. They did argue on the money market funds.
Okay,
that was their argument.
And let's assume for a moment, again, we're all arguing, because I know you love the waiver issue, but let's assume for a moment that we're back in trial, and we have the decision of the court with respect to certain funds, but based upon an assumption that the statute of limitations doesn't continually apply when there's a new breach or failure to, in this case, take an institutionally based or administrated fund versus a retail fund, would that be reopened?
Well, you may think I'm fighting the premise, but the trial court didn't say anywhere that the statute of limitations bars anybody from arguing that you have a continuing duty to monitor any of these funds to determine whether or not the fees are too high or whether there was better available options. The trial court never said that.
Okay, well, it gets back to the waiver issue, but the Supreme Court said, we'll put the waiver issue aside for a moment. The Circuit's going to decide that, but the Ninth Circuit didn't properly apply trust law. The Supreme Court was unfair about that. Now, the question here is, if we get to that point and we apply the trust law properly, don't you really get back to a new trial? And the question I'm talking about now is which funds get included, just the ones that were 3-6 years, or do you include some of the ones that were already litigated? Because there's at least an argument that the proper fees were not charged. Is that a fair statement?
I'm not sure. I mean, I think the only thing that could get litigated now, if I could just answer it that way, it would be they already challenged 3 funds that ran it during the limitations period. That's over. And if there were a remand again, which I want to get to argue about, if there were a remand, the only thing they could challenge were the 3 funds that they did challenge and make an argument at trial about, because they have never argued that there's a limitations. That's not been part of their argument, the limitations period barred them from asserting this kind of challenge.
Let me ask one question, because I know my colleagues have questions too. But on the revenue sharing, how many tens of thousands of dollars over the time period that we're talking about did Edison receive from mutual funds that had the retail investment supervision?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay.
It's on the record, but I don't know the answer.
Okay. But it would have been a fair amount of money, right? You're talking about lots of beneficiaries.
Right. It was used to defray the cost of administration.
I understand what it's used for. I'm just saying it's a lot of money. And where in the plan does Edison have the right to revenue share in such a situation?
I mean, I don't have a citation to that because it wasn't raised. It may be there, but can I tell you the answer to the question on disclosure?
Okay.
It was negotiated when the whole thing was first raised in 1999. It was negotiated, and Edison said to the negotiators on behalf of the employees, we're going to use revenue sharing because it will defray the cost of administration. Otherwise, it's going to be more costly. 17 different times it was disclosed to all of the participants that revenue sharing was being used.
Okay.
Everybody knew there was revenue sharing.
Okay, so that's important. And where is that on the record?
I don't know. If you look at the briefs in the original appeal where this was addressed and not appealed by the plaintiffs to the Supreme Court, they've never complained about that in the Supreme Court. And I think the court only vacated the panel decision with respect to limitations, not this issue. And finally, I would say the trial record showed that there was no breach of the duty of loyalty in using revenue sharing because almost every time a new fund was adopted, a fund was chosen that didn't have revenue sharing when it could have been. So the court, as a matter of fact, rejected the loyalty.
So from your perspective, the beneficiaries, either through the representatives or through written disclosure, were told that a piece of the administrative cost of their fund was going to Edison to help defray bookkeeping expenses?
Yes.
Okay.
I just want to make sure I understood your comment a minute ago, which is that the only thing we really have to decide here is whether or not there's been waiver.
Yeah, that's the principal thing. Yes,
that's
for
it.
Sure. Yes.
And if we disagree with your position, we would remand it back down to the trial court to proceed
I suppose it's theoretically possible you could remand it to the district court to determine whether it was waived at trial.
Correct.
That's a possible outcome. But if you find, as a matter of law, on the record you have that there's no waiver, then yes, it would go back for trial on these three funds. But let me get back to the waiver in question, which is, again, it's not just me. I mean, the three judges, panel judges who looked at all the record said it was waived. And it's not just a waiver, failure to articulate. Their position is that they didn't raise it because the summary judgment order prevented them from doing so. It's a simple sort of on-off switch. So let's look at the summary judgment order and figure out where it is.
Before we do that, I just want to make sure I understand your position. Is it your position that they didn't raise it in the complaint? I see failure to monitor all through the complaint. So is it your position that they didn't raise it in the complaint, or is it they dropped it at trial?
It's that really that they dropped it at trial.
Right. So
they had this chance to introduce evidence that would support a finding that Edison should have removed the retail funds, switched the retail share classes to institutional share classes during the monitoring period.
So we agree then, I guess, that they raised the claim, and your argument, they assert that they didn't raise it because of the summary judgment argument. You say they could have raised it and they didn't. Is that exactly where we are?
Yes.
Okay.
The summary judgment argument order did not bar them from raising it. So let's look at the summary judgment order. On page 18, there's the general statement of the standard that quotes Phillips. It says there's no continuing violations theory, just quoting Phillips, describing what Phillips says. That after the first alleged breach of fiduciary duty, that any failure to rectify the breach constituted a discrete breach, rejecting that. The court said, again, just quoting Phillips, that although the trustee's conduct could be viewed as a series of discrete breaches, the statute of limitations did not begin anew because each breach was of the same character. Then the court applies that principle to the case before it, right? The next paragraph says, here, neither party has satisfied its burden to alter the statute of limitations from the standard six-year time limit. But what does the court do? It addresses the plaintiff's argument and says, plaintiffs have not shown that defendants made any misstatements or actively concealed any breaches of fiduciary duty, which would toll the statute beyond 6 years. It explains that. It's the only argument they made on summary judgment limitations. One argument.
Why doesn't the language you just read about breaches of the same character? Why doesn't that support their reading that they were then required to show during the limitations period that something had changed, right? That it wouldn't be enough just to show that it was the exact same, misstep that occurred outside the limitations.
Right. The court makes perfectly clear its understanding of trust law, that trust law does permit, require a fiduciary to monitor, and that would be a claim of a different character in the body of the summary judgment order. It actually distinguishes between a claim attacking the initial decision and any claim addressed to monitoring that happens after the initial decision.
Where do you say
it? I'll show you twice. It says it twice. First of all, on page ER93, when it describes how the limitations period applies to the particular claims that the court is considering, on ER93, it says plaintiff's claims for breach of the duty is an independent basis after having granted summary judgment on the merits on most of their claims. Plaintiff's claims for breach of this duty of prudence are barred in many respects by the limitations period. For example, and it goes through three, it gives three of them. It is undisputed that the initial decision to add retail mutual funds, including the sector funds, as an option the plan was made in 1999 and 2000. That's one. Two, Mr. Hertel made the decision to maintain the money market fund instead of use a stable value fund in 1999. That's the initial decision. Two, three, the Edison stock fund was established as a unitized stock fund as early as January 25th, 2001. Thus, the prudence claims arising out of these decisions, those initial decisions just described, are barred by the statute of limitations. Contrast that now, Your Honors, with how the court describes the actual claims on their merits on page 82, ER 82, where the court describes them. Here's what he's talking about. Here's what he's addressing, both on the merits and to limitations. Plaintiffs challenge the following investment decisions. What's before the court? One, the decision to include retail mutual funds as an investment option. That's all they were talking about at that point, was including them. There was no argument in this case that we failed to monitor the share classes until right before trial.
Now, we're out there arguing today, and you can change circumstances that required you to monitor the funds.
That came up in trial after this order.
Yeah.
That's how they were saying that.
It's after the order they pursued the claim that you had a duty to monitor because of changed circumstances.
And they didn't pursue, and that's what I'm going to get to, they did
but
not pursue.
Because of changed circumstances,
right.
You had a duty to monitor.
Well, I wouldn't put it that way. They say we breached the duty to monitor.
You breached. You had a duty to monitor, right, which you breached.
Right.
And they said that duty to monitor was a result of changed circumstances.
Confirming that the other circumstances.
Yes, that's correct.
That's correct.
Yes, okay. So they raised the duty to monitor argument, but they said it was because of changed circumstances. Now, is that dropping the claim of duty to monitor, or is that dropping an argument in favor of the duty to monitor?
I don't know where the distinction would actually play out.
Well, you've got to find out where.
I don't think so.
Just let me finish once. You should find out the distinction, because since 1899, the Supreme Court says you don't waive arguments. You only waive a claim. And even though you drop a theory for a claim or develop a new theory for a claim, even if you don't present it to the trial court, if you present it to the Court of Appeals, you're presenting the claim, even if it's a totally different argument. So you better discover what the difference is between dropping an argument and dropping a claim.
I think there's the difference. It would be treated as a claim here on that dichotomy, if that's what matters, because you cannot. It cannot be the rule that if they could have shown up at trial, if we all agree that they could have argued at trial that Edison breached his routine duty to monitor and should have identified this in the routine duty to monitor, they just flat out didn't.
They did in their complaint.
But they didn't. They chose not to argue at trial. They didn't expert come on and say, I've got a bunch of things to say, and my expert and to testify to. He testified to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It cannot be that you can show up on appeal and say, he didn't testify to 6, 7, or 8, but we'd like to argue that.
But why didn't you say that on appeal?
Because we understood the argument to be a legally different one. It was not that they weren't objecting at that point to anybody having required them to show significant circumstances. They just wanted to say, without talking about the nature of the duty to monitor, which the trial court absolutely allowed them to pursue, without talking about the nature of the duty to monitor, they just wanted to say that the fact that they were in the funds from the beginning was imprudent, and they stayed in the funds, and the breach here was a duty to remove them. It was just a breach, and we heard it again this morning, that the breach here was just a duty, was a breach of the duty to remove the funds without talking about actual monitoring process. And that's what trust law tells us, that's what the Supreme Court tells us, that's what treatises tell us, is that it's a separate duty, and that's why it's not a breach of a claim of the same character. Because you can't just show up and say, I don't like the fact they were in there originally and they should be taking them out. That's never enough. You have to show what a prudent fiduciary would do in the monitoring process, would identify this problem and act upon it, regardless of what happened at the initial selection stage. And that's the argument they never wanted to make, and we responded to that argument by saying, that's just a challenge to the initial breach, and that's not enough.
So
that's what they clarified in the reply brief, that was the nature of their claim.
So why does it make any difference what they did at trial since they're appealing from the summary judgment?
Because, well, I think they have
the Supreme Court's opinion.
See, if you start off with, I mean, if things had stopped right at the point of the summary judgment, if they'd gotten the 54B certification or something and gone straight up, we'd be in the same position. What you seem to be arguing is because they developed it, they didn't assert a theory at trial, that precludes them from raising the issue at summary judgment. But that doesn't quite make sense to me, so you have a different theory, so explain it to me.
Well, I don't think at summary judgment there was anything to complain about based on what they'd already argued. They couldn't have argued on appeal after summary judgment that we should be allowed to challenge the failure to change retail share classes to institutional share classes. They'd never said a word about that in the case to that point. Now, that certainly wouldn't be preserved on appeal under any theory of claim or argument. You can't just show up on appeal and make up a brand new theory of the case and say that summary judgment argument prevented us from making this argument. So what happened in summary judgment is the court did what it did with respect to quoting Phillips, and then said that the initial decisions only, the court is unambiguous about that, are barred. The court then, in describing the actual claims, distinguished the initial decision, the challenge to the initial decision, and to the challenges to the performance. You see that on page ER82. And then look at the court did with respect to the Science and Technology Fund, the Sector Fund challenge, right? The plaintiffs were arguing, one thing they did argue before summary judgment, was that Edison breached its duty with respect to selecting the Science and Technology Fund, and that Edison did not prudently monitor the performance of that fund. All right? If the plaintiff's theory were right, The summary judgment argument order barred them from making that argument because the court understood the limitations period as prohibiting a challenge to the performance after selection. Then the court would have granted summary judgment on limitations with respect to the science and technology fund, but the court didn't.
Wasn't it also your understanding from the summary judgment order that the claims would be precluded absent evidence of a change in circumstances? So as I understand it, that was the plaintiff's trial strategy, was to say, okay, now I've got the summary judgment order. It basically precluded certain claims as outside the statute of limitations. So, you know, I'm reasonably, and speaking for plaintiffs here, my understanding of their position is I reasonably interpret this order to say that I'm precluded from presenting evidence with regard to those claims unless I can come up with evidence of changed circumstances. And from reading the record, that seems to be your understanding of the summary judgment order as well.
It wasn't. We didn't say that at trial. We didn't say that on appeal.
I'm looking at, and I don't have a record site handy, but it's in your post-trial briefing where you say, by challenging the prudence of maintaining retail share classes of the three name change funds, plaintiffs have done what the court has forbidden by attempting to resurrect claims that were properly held bar by the statute of limitations. So it just seems like you're slicing it really thin. What's the distinction there?
Right. That's exactly what the same argument we then made on appeal. All they're doing, but they're just challenging the maintaining without ever having said anything about our monitoring process. They never articulated in terms of here's what a prudent fiduciary would do and here's the problem. So just by saying you maintained them is just an end run around the limitations ruling. And the next paragraph, I think, of that opinion, which I don't have right in front of me, of that brief, actually acknowledges their argument and says the trial argument they did make and explains why that's wrong. So we never understood the trial court's orders having done that, nor did the plaintiffs, because they challenged the money market fund.
I thought that the panel on the first appeal actually read the order in the same way that they are. In other words, I thought our panel said the district court ruled that nothing about those funds that were added before the statute of limitations period began.
Right.
Nothing about the decision with respect to those funds can be challenged within the limitations period unless there have been such a significant change in circumstances so as to trigger a full review as though it were an initial decision to add it.
Right, the court didn't say that's not what the panel decision says with respect, Your Honor. What the panel decision says is responding to their point that this would mean an imprudent fund is frozen in the plan forever, and the court said that's not true because you can continue to challenge because of the duty to monitor. The court specifically quoted this court's Kwan decision, which acknowledged the continuing duty to monitor, and the court said all it said was the district court was therefore proper to allow the plaintiffs to put on a case of change circumstances.
Right, but it's that. But read the district court as having said that's the only way they could make any challenge with respect to those.
Right. I just don't see that in the panel decision. It doesn't say it's the only way. What the court is correctly doing is describing what the plaintiffs were allowed to do because that's what the plaintiffs want to do. That's what they chose to do with respect to the retail mutual funds. Your Honors, they challenged the money market fund. The performance of the money market fund, the objected at trial to Edison's failure to monitor the fees in the money market fund. I submit that that is utterly irreconcilable with either the fact of the summary judgment ruling having barred an argument like that or their understanding of the summary judgment ruling.
If that's true, how then do you explain the fact that the first question presented in the certificate with the petition for certiorari, they said, notwithstanding the ongoing nature of ERISA's fiduciary duties, does the statute of limitations inside of the section immunize 401k plan fiduciaries for retaining imprudent investments that continue to cause the plan losses if the funds were first included in the plan more than 6 years ago? The Supreme Court said, Ninth Circuit, you didn't properly apply trust law. Go back and take a look at it. You can look at the waiver issue too, but you didn't properly apply trust law. So they at least read that to understand the point that my colleague has just mentioned here. They didn't figure that there was nothing before them. And the question, did you answer that? Arguably, you waived the issue before the Supreme Court.
Well, we definitely didn't waive from the Supreme Court, which is also the answer to your question, which is the court recognized in the last paragraph of its opinion that it's up to this court. If we waived it, the court wouldn't have addressed it. So you still directed this court to consider it.
You said in your brief in opposition that, Supreme Court, don't waste your time on this case because this issue isn't even before you.
We definitely opposed and said the question wasn't that added.
Brief in opposition.
I understand that, but the Supreme Court, we did argue it on the merits.
Right.
The Supreme
it's too late.
No, but it's not because the Supreme
Court. Why haven't you waived this by not asserting it in your brief in opposition?
Because the Supreme Court said we didn't waive it. The Supreme Court
didn't.
No,
and they didn't.
They said just go take another look, which includes waivers of the waiver point, right? Only, I think, with respect to this court, it's up to the Supreme Court to decide whether or not it was waived in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court not only didn't say that, it directed this court to consider whether it had been waived at trial. That was the Supreme Court's direction to the Ninth Circuit. You decide whether or not the plaintiffs had an opportunity to raise this at trial. And they clearly did, as demonstrated by the Money Market Fund, and they clearly did, as demonstrated by the court's treatment at page ER82 of the Science and Technology Sector Fund, where in that summary judgment order, in the same summary judgment order, the court addresses on the merits the alleged failure to monitor the performance of that fund.
You have only yourself to blame for being back here because you could have had this case end at the cert stage if it had been so clear, as you're now arguing, that this was never preserved at any stage of the proceedings. You could have said that in your brief in opposition, and I'm sure the Supreme Court would have let the case go.
Well, I don't know that.
There you are.
Well, but the court, we opposed certiorari and said the question wasn't presented, for sure, and the court agreed with us that it was appropriate for this court now to decide the question whether or not the trial court gave the plaintiffs an opportunity to make the argument they want to make, and the trial court summary judgment order unambiguously provided them that opportunity, as evidenced by the fact that they actually made precisely the same argument with respect to the money market fund. Both challenges were identical. The objection to the money market fund was that Edison, during the monitoring period, didn't perform a prudent monitoring process and identify those fees. Same argument with respect to the retail mutual, the mutual funds, was that the fees were too high because Edison, during the monitoring process, didn't identify the availability of lower share claims.
Thank you
very much.
Judge Watford, I think the relevant portion of the panel's opinion was on page 1120, where the court said the district court allowed beneficiaries to put on evidence that significant changes in conditions occurred within the limitations period that should have prompted a, quote, full due diligence review of the funds, equivalent to the diligence review defendants conduct when adding new funds to the plan. These particular beneficiaries could not establish changed circumstances engendering a new breach. But the district court was entirely correct to have entertained the possibility. Now, there's no question but that Edison understood that to be the court's summary judgment order, at least until we get to the merits of the Supreme Court. Because Edison says, in the second brief on cross appeal, page 18, plan fiduciaries do have a continuing duty under ERISA to monitor investment options for changed circumstances, they said, rendering it once prudent investment, now imprudent. But plaintiffs here allege no changed circumstances, just as you are getting to, Judge Yoon. They instead assert that the decision to include certain options was imprudent ab initio. The limitations period for that claim expired 6 years after the decision was implemented. In other words, Edison saying that these are all claims of the same character. Because you started outside of the limitations period, it's barred. They say that the district court properly applied Phillips to the limitations statute.
And their position seems to be that absent changed circumstances, you don't have to do anything.
Correct, Your Honor. Absolutely.
And at least Section 90 of the Restatement Third suggests that there's a continuing duty to monitor the appropriateness of investments, not just based on changed circumstances. Is that correct?
Absolutely, Your Honor.
And can I ask you this? How do you mean Mr. Hacker's argument that you argued the breach of the duty to monitor with respect to the money market fund? And the panel decision says, but you didn't argue that with respect to the mutual funds.
My colleague is incorrect on that. What we argued up to summary judgment was that they should have been in a stable value fund instead of a money market fund. The court found that claim barred because that decision was made more than 6 years ago. What we argued as to the money market fund was that because of changed circumstances, they should have reduced the fees. The changed circumstances being the plan's assets invested in that fund had gone up significantly, and the market rates for managing money market funds had gone down. So in light of those changed circumstances, they should have reduced the fees.
Successfully argued change circumstances, the money fund unsuccessfully with the mutual funds.
Right, except we were unsuccessful on the money market fund because the district court found, well, they did reduce the fees at some point, and that's good enough, and so we lost on the merits. But again, the money market fund claim was strictly within the ambit of change circumstances. And we're going to argue that as to those three retail mutual funds because they hadn't changed names or anything like that. And I'm sorry if I'm belaboring the point, but I'd also direct the court's attention to page 26 of Edison's brief on appeal of the second proof. Plaintiffs and DOL contend that application of the continuing violation doctrine in this context is required by the ongoing duty of the fiduciary to monitor plan investments. Not so. A fiduciary does have a continuing duty to monitor each investment's performance, recognizing, of course, that past performance is no guarantee of future performance, and to ensure that circumstances have not changed enough to render the option inappropriate for the plan. And later on that page, but plaintiffs here do not contend that defendants fail to respond to any such changed circumstances. There is no question in our mind, in their mind, in the panel's mind, but what was the scope and meaning of that summary judgment order? Only if you can show changed circumstances, something different from what happened outside of the limitations period, do you have an actionable claim. And the Supreme Court said no. Retention of an imprudent investment option is an act or omission that is a breach that is actionable under the 6-year limitations period. Because of that ruling, this case needs to be remanded back to the district court so we can have a full trial on the merits of the imprudence of having these retail class mutual funds in the plan.
Counsel, refresh me on one issue. I looked through your brief. Did you appeal anything that occurred at trial? Or did you just appeal the summary judgment?
No, yes, we appealed the merits of the decisions that were made at trial.
Thank you, counsel. Thank you both for your arguments. This case will be submitted for decision.